Climate change, there's a huge debate over it, and it's going to put further restrictions on production capacities across the world. Do you think that this will affect trade?
Well, you're right. I think the debate about climate change and trade is going to be the next big challenge. I must say, I think we in Europe are very sensitive to the fact that it's not very fair to say to the emerging developing countries, you must cap your carbon emissions without taking account of the fact, of course, that for many hundreds of years we've been polluting the planet and we're now faced with that legacy and not the legacy of what some of the developing countries have been doing. However, I think it is in all our interests to try to build a global consensus about how we reduce carbon emissions, without which we know we're heading to some serious climatic difficulties, much of which will affect the developing world more than the developed. So the developing world also has a stake in this. But we have to find a deal which is balanced and which enables the developing countries to continue to grow, to produce the additional wealth which they need to move from poverty to prosperity and to offer a better lifestyle to all of their people. But in a way, perhaps they can find a better way of doing it than simply replicating the very torturous path that the West followed over 200 years.
Now, the key question which everybody is asking in, and you're in a right position to answer, when will global trade rebound? What will global trade depend on for it to come back?
I think trade is very simply dependent on the overall level of economic activity. The fall-off in trade that we have seen in the last 12 months has been exclusively due to the fact that there's less economic activity. Growth figures have fallen dramatically across the world, therefore there's less trade. Once those growth figures pick up again, there will be more trade. There's nothing in the recent fall off in trade which has to do with protectionism or with resistance to globalization. It's a simple mechanical relationship between a downturn in economic activity and then less goods being traded because less things are happening economically. There's widespread public perception that somehow ordinary people lose out from free trade. This is not true. Free trade generates, we have outsourced a lot of jobs in Europe to India and to China, but we've created many more jobs at home precisely because we have outsourced some of our jobs, which has made our companies more competitive. Then they're able to create different kinds of jobs back in Europe, and the figures prove this. But of course, it's not what people necessarily feel on a day-to-day basis. Equally, in India, many people, poor farmers, probably feel our opening up of markets will mean less prospects for me. So there is really a need for a process of explaining to people why trade benefits everyone and how we can have a global open trading system that is to everyone's benefit, on the condition, of course, that governments are able to put in place the accompanying policies which cushion the people most immediately affected from the worst effects.
Also, can you tell us about the status of the Indo-EU FTA negotiations? Have been on for a while. How soon do you think that this will be concluded?
Well, we launched the negotiations about 2 years ago. We have made good progress. We are intensifying now with the new government and the new trade minister. We are now reactivating and intensifying the negotiations. I hope that the upcoming summit in November will give additional impetus. And our mutual objective, I think, is to try to conclude this agreement by the end of next year in 2010. The challenge, of course, will be the degree of opening of agricultural industrial products, where India will have some sensitivities. We will also have some sensitivities. We have to find the balance there. I think for us, a very important issue is the possibility to participate in government procurement issues, not at the state level, which I think we recognize would be difficult. But I think it would be very hard for Europe to accept a free trade agreement with India that did not give us access to at least federal government procurement. I know this is extremely sensitive. On the other hand, we would argue that Indian companies already have quite a lot of access to government procurement in Europe, but maybe we could consolidate that and improve it and give it a better base. I think the issue of movement of professionals in the context of services, what we call mode four in the jargon, will be an important issue for India, a slightly sensitive issue on the European side because of the employment situation, but I'm absolutely sure that we will not reach an agreement without a significant move on our part in this area of sensitivity for India.